Good morning, Mount Zion. Good morning to our virtual family, virtual friends who have decided today to join in on this morning's broadcast. We are glad. We are grateful. We are just so thankful for your presence on this morning. You watching us, you tuning in with us this morning. But before we express any more gratitude or appreciation, let us direct that to our God. Hallelujah. For him protecting us and preserving us through this week. Man, what a trying week for our faith and for our belief in God being a refuge for us. And we want to just stop right now and just thank him for protecting us, from him shielding us, and for his hand of grace and mercy that he bestowed upon us. We had a rough week. We started off facing two hurricanes, two terrible storms that it looked like it was going to be. But even as we're talking about how things are unpredictable, we never can predict how things are going to play out. But we know, trusting God, we can predict that he's going to bring us out. We may not know just how it's going to play out, but we trust that he's going to bring us out. So we are so grateful and thankful for God on that, for doing that. And we want to keep our brothers and our sisters in prayers, those in the Lake Charles area, those in the Texas coastline area, those in the Louisiana coastline, the coastal areas. They suffer so much devastation, so much destruction, but we know that people from this area have left and gone to stand those brothers and sisters up, just as they did us back in 2016 when we suffered destruction and devastation. So keep them in your prayers. Keep them lifted up before the Lord. And we know that he's going to bring full restoration to that area and to those people. Listen, want to remind you that we are in our 21 days of prayer. On Saturday, we started day number 6. So here we go with our scriptures. So day number 6. As the text message went out on our messaging system on yesterday morning, day number 6, you should have started off with 2 Timothy 2:15. 2 Timothy 2:15. Day 7 of our 21 days of prayer, you're going to pray, you're going to read Isaiah 41:10. Isaiah 41:10. Day 8, you're going to read Ecclesiastes 9:10. Day 9, you're going to read Hebrews 12:2. And day number 10, we're going to look at 1 Peter 5:8. And listen, we want to pray those scriptures. We want to meditate on those scriptures. Remember, the Bible says that if we would meditate on his book day and night, you know, if we would keep his word, it said the Bible tells us that then whatsoever we do, it shall prosper. Well, I want you to know that if we pray God's word, if we bring his word back to him, the word tells us, his word tells us, the word that he gave as a word for his people, his word tells us that his word cannot return to him void. So as we are looking for a refocusing, as we are looking for us to get refocused on the objectives and on the vision, and prioritizing, even in the midst of a pandemic, prioritizing even in the midst of crisis, we want to refocus, and we want to get back to seeing God and to hearing God in the stillness of life, even when it's crazy and it's just filled with clutter and doom and gloom. We want to refocus, and we want to hear, and we want to not only hear, but we want to see from God as well. So we're going to continue with our 21 days of prayer. We're going to continue with that. Hey, still want to encourage you all to check out our website, www.mountzionbcdville.org. Encourage you to give. That giving platform is through Givelify, and also you can give on our website. So we encourage you to check those things out. We want to remind you that the only reason that we can be that progressive church is by the power of God. But the way that we proclaim the gospel is by his power and by you supported this ministry as well. Excuse me. So I want to remind you that we're a progressive church that proclaims the gospel and pursues the kingdom. So I want to just thank you all for being dedicated and devoted in your giving and being committed to honoring God with the first fruits of your increase. And I just pray God's favor and his blessing upon all that have been giving in the midst of crisis, in the midst of pandemic. We still serve an awesome God. I want to say happy birthday to Sister Cameron LeBuck. She celebrated her birthday on last week. Happy birthday to you, Cam. Happy birthday to our minister of music. Happy birthday to you, Brother Lawrence Brown. They celebrated a birthday this past week as well. So to those two, we want to say happy birthday. We love you. God bless you. Hey, listen, our worship team is ready. They're going to come before you with the word, with the worship. I'll be back to you with the word. That's how I want to say it. They're coming with the worship. You join in that worship. I'm going to come to you with the word. Join in with me on that word as well. Stay tuned. They're ready. Brother BJ Smith is up next. God bless you.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, Mount Zion. Another blessed day. Hey, we found in the house of the Lord. Man, that's such a sweet spirit in this place already. Before we even get into it, man, God is here. God is here. Let him rest with you in your cars, in your homes, wherever you are. Let God rest. Let him rule. Let him reign with you. This is before we get started. He's already with us, so we're going to go straight into it. God, we thank you. We love you, God. You're such a great and awesome God. God, we thank you for keeping us this far in this pandemic. We just thank you, God. You're such a great and awesome God, man. We can't stop, God. I can't stop thanking you this morning. God, we thank you for family. We thank you for ministry. God, we get the opportunity to do this thing this morning, God. And we are grateful and thankful. God, as our man of God comes forward with the word, God, we ask that you anoint his mind, his heart, his spirit, God. That the word will come, that it will meet your people right where you are, right where they are, God. As praise and worship go forth, God, we ask you that. Bring everything back to our remembrance, God, to exalt your name, to praise your name, in the mighty name of Jesus, God. God, we just thank you. We thank you. God, I hear you saying, just trust me. Just trust me. If you will only
Lord, you are good. You've been better than good. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. Can't praise you enough. Even if I tried, you've been so good, you've been so good, you've been so good to me. Oh, you are good. Oh,
really see disruptions and disturbances of life. And even when we look at the story of Lazarus, how we see that the disruptions and the disturbances of life even brought about death, we still are not able to predict how things will work out. They are literally unpredictable. But what we can predict is that God will, and He has, and He's going to see us through. So let's jump in. Let's jump in the second installment of this message called Unpredictable. So we're going to be in John chapter 11. We're going to pick up our reading at verse number 11. John chapter 11, verse number 11. It says this. It says, "These things said He, and after that He said to them, Our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep." So let's just look at that verse right there. Let's just talk about it. It was not on last week. I talked about how it was a disturbance for Lazarus. It was a disturbance for Mary. It was a disturbance or a disruption in the life of Martha. So we see three individuals that had a disruption that they did not know. They could not dictate, or they could not predict that this disruption, this disturbance in their life, they could not even picture this in a million years, that this was going to happen. Now maybe they understood that it could happen, but you can never predict when disturbances, when disruptions will happen. So not only do we see those three individuals being a part of disruptions or having disturbances take place in their life. Now, those are the more critical ones, because it was Lazarus who, when his life was disrupted and his life was disturbed, he experienced death, right? It was his sisters, Martha and Mary, when their lives became disrupted and disturbed, they saw their brother experience the death. They felt the hurt of his death, right? But we want to look at two other individuals or two other people or groups that were also had disruptions. So let's look at the disciples. They were going about. They were going about following Christ. They were going about fulfilling the work and the will that God had given to them through Christ. Right? If you read in John chapter 10, Christ had just gave the discourse on being the good shepherd. He had just asserted his deity. In the end part of John chapter 10, he had just asserted that there would be no division, right? So they're now going about. They're going about trying to follow, one, the good shepherd. They're going about, one, trying to learn from his deity. And they're going about trying to bring back the unity that had been divided and had been destroyed by religious leaders and by religion and by the law. So as we looked on last week, we looked at and the thought came up that you know, the tradition, you know, the lessons learned may not make that when we have disturbances, they may be there to teach us a new lesson. They may be there to provide for us a new tradition. So what we see is they are now on a journey. They are now on assignment following Christ. And I want you to get this, because I'm about to drop my first point. I'm about to drop my point here. The Bible says that Jesus said these things to them after he had told them about how they should seize the opportunity of working during the day. Verse 9 and 10, he says to them that, are there not 12 hours in the day? He wants them to understand, seize every opportunity to work while it's day, to move about while it's day, For when night cometh, no man is going to be able to find his way. Another translation, another portion of scripture. But in this portion of scripture, he says, if any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, right? You have less problems. You have less pitfalls when you seize the opportunity to work, when God gives you the opportunity to work. Amen, somebody. But then when you try to work outside of the scope of God, or outside of the will of God, or outside of the perspectives of God, then you find yourself stumbling. Then you find the pitfalls. Then you find the real hindrances that are so hard to get over. Not saying that if you're seizing the opportunity, if you're seizing it when God says seize it, or you move when God says move, not saying that you're not going to have hindrances, not saying you're not going to have setbacks, but what you're going to experience is that when you seize the opportunity when God says to do it, you may have a setback, but that setback is a setup. All right, I want you to get that. So he moves from telling him that. He says, he tells him, now we must go. He says, now I go that I may awake him out of his sleep. Now, they had already just told Jesus, let's not go back that way. Let's not go that route, because the people of Judea wanted to kill them. So here they think they're following Christ. They think they're fulfilling the will of God, and a disturbance comes, and that disturbance comes, and it can bring not only destruction or devastation to Christ, but it can bring destruction. It can bring destruction and devastation to them. But you have to understand. Here goes my first point. We should never allow distractions, disruptions, or disturbances dictate your direction. Okay, look at the direction of Christ. Christ is saying, listen, we have a disruption, right? Because remember, Jesus was brought the word by the sisters, well, he was brought word by those that had the word or had the information that Lazarus had died. And Jesus says, okay, this is an opportunity. This is a chance for me to exploit, for me to put on display the power of God, right? In divinity, in deity, he says, this is an opportunity for me to really show the awesome power of God. And this display, okay, it's going to be one of never before, because what he shows, well, not say never before, but what it happened a few times. But what he shows is, he shows the resurrection power. He shows the resurrection power of God. So you never let disturbances, you never let distractions, you never let disruptions dictate your direction. Because what you have to understand is that those disturbances, those distractions, and those disruptions, watch Christ now. If he would have said, no, well, Lazarus is dead, that's too hard. That's too hard. So this disturbance here is going to dictate my direction. I'm going to allow that. I'm going to allow this to dictate my direction. And I'm not going to go, because that may be, you know, when we think of death, that's the point of the place of no return. But once again, we have to understand, when we are in the direction of the divine, when we are following the distinct directions of the divine, then we understand that there is nothing too hard. Right? So never, my brothers and sisters, never allow disturbances, distractions, or disruptions. Never let them dictate your direction. So here goes the direction. The direction is, Jesus says, but I go that I may awake him out of his sleep. Verse 12, then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking a rest in sleep. Then Jesus says to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And I am glad, watch this, for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent that you may believe. Nevertheless, watch the direction, let us go unto him. So here, we are about to see that not only was the distraction or the disruption there to direct them, right? The distraction came not only for them, but the direction came for Christ too, right? The disruption comes for Christ too, because Christ was going about, right? Christ was going about to the places and going about doing the things that God had called him to do. And now this distraction comes up. So I want you to get that. I want you to see that. Not only was it a distraction or a disruption or disturbance in the life of the disciples, but it was one for Christ too. It was one for Christ too. It was one for the divine too. But I want you to see what he now does. He displays dominion. Get that? He displays dominion even during a dead disruption. This disruption here brought about death for his friend Lazarus. And I'm going to bring that home. I'm going to bring that home. It brings about a disruption even for his friend Lazarus. His friend Lazarus had a disruption in his life. His sister Mary and Martha had a disruption. The disciples had a disruption. And Jesus now faces this disruption. But look at what Jesus does. Jesus says, even though it's a disruption, even though this has taken me off track of where I am going or where I am to go, right? What I'm about to do is I'm about to display dominion. I want you to say that with me, dominion. He now displays dominion. He now displays authority. He now displays power even over a dead situation, even over a dead disruption, right? So we take note, not from the disciples, because look at what the disciples were thinking. The disciples were thinking that, oh, this disruption is only to rest, right? But Jesus says plainly to them, no, this disruption is a dead disruption. This disturbance is a dead disturbance. They were thinking of it as a disturbance or a disruption for rest and relaxation. But Jesus said, no, this disruption is for resurrection. Oh, get that. They were thinking about it as for rest and relaxation for their friend Lazarus. And Jesus said, no, he's dead. Plainly, he is dead. But I want you to see something that is nestled in the text. It's nestled to be a nugget for you. It's nestled. He says to them, he says that I am glad for your sakes that the disturbance comes up. I'm in 15. He says, I'm glad that I was not there when this happened to my friend Lazarus, right? Now you remember, he's tarrying. And as I said on last week, when God tarries, he tarries to teach us. When he lingers so we should learn. When God takes his time, he takes his time so we can be taught. And the disciples now are about to learn a great and valuable lesson. Now, many feel that when they're going through, it's for them. Many feel when they experience hurt, when they experience loss, when they experience removal of something or someone, they think that it's for them. Can I tell you, my brother and my sister, can I tell you, child of God, what we go through and what we experience, how we are disturbed, how we are disrupted, how our life sometimes comes in shambles, is not for us. It's not always for us. Most of the time, it's for somebody else. All you have to be able to rejoice. You have to be able to shout over that this morning, because what you're going through, what you're experiencing, it is not for you. It may not be for you, but what we have to, and what we gain from it is, where our rejoicing should be is, it's not for me, you know, to get the testimony, or it's not for me to see the miracle, for me to see the breakthrough, but all of this is happening to me. All of the struggle is placed upon me. All of the pain, all of the agony is placed on me, but it's for somebody else to rejoice? Oh yeah, that's how God works. That's how God works. And God says, this disruption that Lazarus, Martha, Mary, the disciples, and even himself, it was not for Lazarus, Mary, or Martha. Who was it for? It was for the disciples. So here we're going to see that we're going to begin to see some things unfold, and we're going to see some things begin to flow towards us that are going to bless us, right? You should never allow a dead disruption to defeat or to destroy your dominion, right? Right? Christ tells us that when he gets ready to depart, he tells his disciples, greater work shall you do. But he tells them here in this text, he says, what I'm glad about is, what I'm rejoicing about is, I want y'all to see it. He says, what I'm glad about in 15. So he literally says, what I'm rejoicing about is that what Lazarus is going through or has gone through, it ain't for Lazarus. What I'm happy about, what I'm excited about is what my friend is experiencing is not for my friend. It's for you. It's for the disciples. So the Bible said that Jesus tells them, he says, it is for the intent that you may believe. And what he now is about to do is he is about to exert and exploit and display his dominion even over dead situations, right? So he says this. Nevertheless, let us go to them. Now listen to the disciples. One in particular, then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, right? Unto his fellowship disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. So here Thomas is thinking, well, we're going into a dead situation. We're going into a place where they want to kill us. We're going to a place where they could kill us. But I can't fathom in my mind that we're going to get out of this. So he turns to his fellow disciples and says, right after Christ tells them that what I'm going to do is not for Lazarus, but it's for you to believe. And then Thomas opens up right after those divine words and says, well, fellows, well, brothers, let us go die with him. Watch this. Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Another translation, another passage says that he's been in the grave for 4 days and he's stinking. Guess what? You're going to experience some rot. You're going to experience some decay in dead situations. But you still display dominion even in those stinking, in those rotting, in those decaying situations. Watch Jesus. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs long, and many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him. But still Martha was in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou had been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Look at that. Look at that. Mary doesn't even want to come out of the house. Martha comes and meets him and comes and says, well, Lord, if you would have been here, Lazarus would not have died. Lazarus would not have passed away. But I know that even though he is dead, whatever you ask of God, God will give it to you. She knows that he is now about to display his dominion, right? She understands that he is now about to put on display the power that he has from his heavenly Father. Watch. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Now I want you to hear those words. He calls her his brother. He tells Martha that Lazarus, even though he is dead, he is still your brother. I want to say something there. We should never allow the ruins of a relationship to define your response. What are you saying there, Pastor? The ruins of a relationship. For some people, when they think of death, that's the end of life. That is just the severance of life when we experience death. But this is what Jesus looks at. Jesus looks at not the ruin of the relationship. Jesus has a response. Jesus has a response to the relationship. If you go back a few verses, Jesus calls Lazarus his friend. Even though he's dead, he calls him his friend. Speaking as if he's still here with us, right? When people lose a friend, they say, oh, I lost a friend, I lost a good person. Right? Jesus is speaking, still, he's my friend. Jesus speaks. And in regards to the relationship, no matter how we feel, it has been ruined by death, it has been ruined by problems, it has been ruined by trouble. Jesus says to Martha, he says, your brother shall live again. Your brother shall rise again, right? So Jesus calls Lazarus his friend, even though he was dead. Jesus calls Lazarus Martha's brother, even though he was dead. Why? Because he is now about to display dominion. And we should never allow the ruins of a relationship. We should never allow the ruins of a relationship to define our response. Get that. Never allow the ruins of a relationship to define your response. Because guess what? People will say your marriage is ruined. People will say that your relationship with your children, your relationship with your loved ones, it's ruined, but your response will be, no, it may be dead right now, or it may stink right now, it may have some decay on it now, but guess what? My response is, it's gonna live again. That family member that you've just been separated from, that family member that you've been departed from because of some disturbance or because some distraction or some disruption, no, you exhibit, you display, you show, you present dominion over that situation, and you say, no, the relationship, the partnership, the friendship is going to live again. It's going to live again. Now watch this, and I'm trying to bring this thing to a close. So the word tells us, the word says that Martha understands that whatever Jesus is going to ask of God, God is going to give it to her. Martha says to him in verse 24, she says unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection. I am the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he says in 26, and whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Do you believe this, Martha? She says to him, yeah, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into this world. And when she had said, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, the master is come, and he calleth for thee. It says, and as soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. Now, Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where Martha met him. And the Bible says that the Jews were with her in the house, and they comforted her. When they saw Mary, that she had rose up hastily, went out, they followed her, right? Saying, she goeth unto the grave to weep there. Then when Mary was come where Jesus was, she saw him, fell down at his feet, and saying unto him, Lord, if thou would have been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw and heard her weeping, and the Jews also which came with her, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled. And he said, where have you laid him? Now watch this. The death of Lazarus, we've looked at so far six points on what the death of Lazarus brought. Last week we looked at it brought hope. It brought an opportunity. It brought a chance to seize every opportunity that God was giving you. It brought you a place. It brought you a chance in the place or in the time of tarrying. It brought you teaching. It brought you learning. But what we have seen today is that the disturbances and the distractions and the disruptions don't dictate your direction. Think about this. If all of that would have dictated the direction that Jesus was to go in, that the disciples were to go in, the doubt that they had, this would not have happened. Then we see that you should display dominion even in dead situations, even in dead disruption, right? We saw the power that he spoke of. And the authority that he spoke of, how Lazarus was going to live again and Lazarus was going to rise again, right? But now we still see doubt. And so far we've seen doubt in the disciples, but now we see doubt in the sisters. We see doubt in Lazarus's loved ones, right? And the Bible says, Jesus displays and he says, where have you laid? Then said the Jews, after Jesus weeps, behold how he loves him. Yes, he loves him. If he didn't love him, he wouldn't be there. And that's right where I want to close at. And we have run short of time this morning. But what I want to say is the reason, even when you cannot predict, even when you cannot figure it out, even when you cannot understand how it's going to play out or how you're going to come out, you understand, you gain strength, you gain strength in your faith, you gain fortitude in your faith, you gain courage in your faith by knowing that the God that you serve, the God that we serve, he loves us. He loves us. And the onlookers are saying, oh, look how Jesus is weeping. He loved him. Don't you ever forget that. Don't you ever forget that. Even in the disturbances, even in the distractions, even in the disruptions of life, and you cannot predict how you're going to come out, understand that he loves you, that he loves us. Oh, what manner of love that he has for us. He loves us. The Bible says that some of them said that he could not help this man, right? He could not save him, right? The text says, and some of them said, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused even this man should not have died? They're trying to predict how it's going to play out or how it already has played out. And they forgot one key factor, that Jesus loved Lazarus. So watch this, watch this. I'm going to close this. I'm going to close with this. The sixth thing that we gained from the death of Lazarus is the death of Lazarus was to defeat and to destroy the doubt. So now the crowd is doubting. Now the crowd has tried to predict how it's going to play out. And we know the story. We know the rest of the story. We know the story. Jesus walks up to the place where they laid Lazarus. Jesus finds that there is a stone firmly in place where the dead was laid. Not only Lazarus was there. And I've heard great gospel preaching, heard great people exegese this text about how Jesus calls Lazarus by name. Now, I don't want to take anything away. I want to take anything away from that preaching or from that line of thought. Yes, he called him by name because he knew him. And many preachers will say, well, he called him by name so nothing else will come forth. So nobody else will come forth. So Noah wouldn't come forth. So David wouldn't come forth. So Solomon wouldn't come forth. Guess what? He called Lazarus by name because he loved him. He called Lazarus by name not so that something else that was dead or someone else was dead would come forth. He called Lazarus by name because he wanted those who were doubting because of the death, because of the disruption, because of the disturbance. He wanted them to see that I loved him, that I still love him. And I love him to the point to where I still know his name in spite of what he's gone through. That's a word for you. In spite of what you have gone through, in spite of what you have suffered, God still knows our name. And when we cannot predict, when we can't figure it out, he's already worked it out. And the Bible says that he calls Lazarus and he speaks to him and Lazarus comes forth. Lazarus comes forth. And when he comes forth bound in what he had been in. He comes forth bound in what he had been in. And Jesus displays his dominion. He displays his power. And he says to the grave clothes, loosen and let him go. Loosen and let him go. The shout of that text is in verse 45. Yeah, we rejoice over the resurrection. We rejoice over the raising of Lazarus. We rejoice, Mary and Martha, and even Jesus, and even the disciple that had made friends with Lazarus, Mary and Martha. We rejoice that they now have their friends back. But for us, the shout is the conversion and the defeat of doubt. That's point number six. The defeat of doubt all came from the death of Lazarus. Here it is, and we close. The many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did believed on him. Child of God, what you're going through may not be for you. It may be for someone to gain faith, someone to gain hope, someone to even gain salvation. Yes, it's going to be to the glory of God. That sickness that you're going through, it's going to be to the glory of God, and God is going to perform a miracle for you. But it's for somebody else, that somebody else will believe in the power of God. That somebody else will believe in the love of God. That pain that just seemed to be so unbearable from the disruptions and the disturbances that life has thrown your way. It's going to be for the glory of God. It's gonna perform. It's gonna be for you a breakthrough. It's gonna be for you a setup. But not only for you will it bring a blessing, but for somebody else, it gives them a lesson as well. As we move, I just want to pray. And we're gonna close this message here. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for those situations and for those circumstances and for those places of life where we have disruptions and distractions and disturbances. God, I pray, God, that we would first see that you have already figured it out. We would see next, God, that you've already worked it out. And therefore, because you figured it out and worked it out, God, you're going to bring us out. Just as it seemed that Jesus took his time get into the situation and get into the circumstance and get into the problem that his friend who he loved called Lazarus. It's a scene that he took his time getting there, God. But he brought him out. God, it seems that you're taking your time in situations in our lives, but we say, God, take your time. We say, God, do whatever you need to do, God. God, do whatever it is you need to do to bring us out. And we declare now in the name of Jesus that even though it's unpredictable how we got in it, even though we could not predict that it was coming to us, we can predict and we know that you're going to bring us out of it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're going to extend now in this moment, now in this time, an opportunity for someone who may have never accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. We're going to now offer that to you. We're now going to, if you've never accepted the Lord as your personal Savior, I want you to say these words with me. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner. I confess now by mouth, but I believe in my heart that you will save me. You are able to save me from my sins. I want you to know, my friend, if you prayed that prayer, if you said those words, you're now saved. I want you to find yourself, get yourself in a Bible teaching, a Bible believing, and a life-giving church. And I guarantee you, you have made the best decision of your life. To that person that has to rededicate or wants to rededicate their life back into God, if you would just simply just give the Lord total control. If you would be in total submission and surrender now and just say, Lord, I give you control over my life. I guarantee you, you will not regret it. And then if you are looking for a place of worship, I would be so remiss to not urge you, not encourage you to attach yourself to Mount Zion Baptist Church. But we know under these conditions, we're not able to be in person and have in-person worship experiences and services and things of that nature. But what we do encourage you is once we do come back, once we are able to be back in the sanctuary, we pray that you would join us. And I guarantee you, someone will come up to you with a smile on their face. Someone will come up and wrap their arms around you. Someone will let you know that you have made the best decision by attaching yourself to Mount Zion. If you're not near us, I urge you to get yourself in a Bible teaching and a Bible believing, a Bible preaching church and a life giving church. Attach yourself, connect yourself to a man or a woman of God that loves you and loves God. I pray that those three things, as the invitations are given for salvation, for rededication, and for a church home, I pray those things are answered and God puts it on your heart. Now we're going to move into our time to commune with God, for us to commune with God. I pray that you have your sacraments ready. For those that don't know, we do partake of the Lord's broken body and his shedded blood as often as we get a chance to, or as often as God will give us an opportunity to do. So we do that every Sunday. We commune with God every Sunday. We eat of his body and we drink of his blood every Sunday. So I pray that you would get those two sacraments. Get something that resembles or represents the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and ask that you to get your form of something that represents the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So as we make ready, we want God to bless this bread and bless this cup. We want it to be nourishing and strengthening and reviving and refreshing to our bodies and our souls. It's in Jesus' name. Now, the Bible says that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he desired to eat with his disciples one more time. And after they had eaten, he now gives them a spiritual. He gives them a spiritual meal. He says to them, he says, take, eat, this is my body, which is going to be broken for you. He lifts it up, he gives thanks, and he breaks it. He says, as often as you eat of this bread, do it in remembrance of me. Let us eat together. He then takes the cup. He says to his disciples, he said, this cup is the New Testament, the new covenant of my blood. He says, as often as you drink from this cup, you shall foretell my death until I come again. Let us drink. Bible said that they departed, sung a song, and they departed unto the Mount of Olives. As we close, I want to just remind you, continue to pray, continue to trust God, continue to know that even that moments and times of life are so unpredictable. What we can predict is God is consistently consistent. He has consistently made ways. He has consistently performed miracles. He has consistently brought us over time and time again. That what he said he would do, that shall he perform. So I urge you to keep on looking for God to perform and for God to show up and show out in your life. We love you. We're praying for you. We'll continue to pray for our brothers and sisters in Lake Charles and in the Texas area. And I want you to remember this. The rain falls on the just and the unjust. But what we know is God is there and all. Next week, next time, same time.